Here is another video in our series for building a garage, some type of a unit over a garage. The building is 20 foot wide by 24 foot long. And in this video, we are going to build walls over a floor that is going to be sitting on top of the walls below instead of connecting to them in some way, without any walls dividing into rooms. But I will make another video showing how you might be able to put a bathroom and a kitchen up there and turn something like this into a small studio apartment. So with that said, let's go ahead and take a look at the lower wall framing, where we will have some windows to provide us with some natural lighting for the garage, as well as a door that we might be able to use if we need additional access. Now, the first thing I want to point out here is this type of framing method. You don't have to use it, but often it's difficult to secure a small piece of framing sill plate. So here's something else you could do, and that would simply be to add an anchor bolt in the concrete and then have a couple of framing studs coming off of the wall. You're going to attach this framing stud securely to the wall and the other studs while leaving at least a quarter of an inch space at the bottom, or even an eighth of an inch might be fine. And then you're just simply going to drill a hole in the framing stud that can sit on top of the concrete. And if that's a concern of yours, you're worried about pressure treated lumber, then just use pressure treated lumber for the framing stud and have it sit directly on top of the concrete and provide support for the header. Next up, let's go ahead and add our floor joists. And these are going to be 2x12, 12 inches on center. And we will be installing mid-span blocks here. And I went ahead and moved the stairway over a little bit here so that I could make this area a little larger. And if you remember in the previous videos, I had the 2x12 spaced 16 inches on center. And according to the floor framing span charts, if I was going to use 16 inch on center floor joist for this span, it would need to be select grade lumber. However, something like this could be number 2 or better lumber, which is probably going to be easier to find. And of course, our stairwell. And if you notice, I have a doubler right here underneath the double floor joist, double studs, and the same on the other side, except I didn't feel like I was going to need them over here, so I didn't bother. However, you can go ahead and install double studs there if you want to, or if your engineer requires it. And of course, this side right here will provide us with a 36 inch wide landing. And for those of you who might not have seen this type of framing, we used to use it all the time. Instead of balloon framing the wall, you would simply add a couple of joists where you would have one flush with one side of the wall and the other flush or even with the other side of the wall. And as far as the location of this joist right here, I went ahead and calculated the length so that we would have enough headroom for the stairway. And if that's difficult for you to do, then I would suggest framing the floor and then framing this section and then installing your stairway and then measuring off of the stairway to locate this doubler and then finish framing this section here. Or you can simply move this over a little bit so that you know you will have enough headroom. Next up, let's go ahead and install our floor sheathing. And for this project here, we are going to use 1 1/8 plywood, something else you can use if you want a stronger floor. And then we'll go ahead and frame our walls. And of course, we will be stacking our windows. You can see here where this window stacks directly above this one. And this is often a method they would use years ago when they were balloon framing. However, a lot of architects use it today to keep everything lined up and in proportion. And you can always put additional windows in the front here. And we put one in the back. Now, I want to point out with this window here is that you might want to move it over to here or move it over to here depending upon how the sunlight is going to be entering into the building. For example, if the sun is rarely going to be shining on this wall, then you might want to install a window on this wall and on this wall here, or even down below somewhere to provide enough light for the stairway, natural lighting, if that's going to be a concern of yours. Because this window window here is going to be difficult to clean from the outside and the inside. However, it won't be if it's over here or over here. So keep that in mind when you are designing your project, along with the ladder that you will be using to clean this window. And then of course we have our stairway. And like I said, I moved it over to where I have the minimum distance I need here for the landing size. And this might be something you'll be interested in doing if you're going to make something like this into a closet or something that will require the maximum distance possible. And of course, our doorway is located to where we will be able to go into the garage or up the stairs. And that wouldn't be the case if we had the door over here somewhere. We would be able to enter into the garage, but we would have to walk all the way around to go up the stairs. And if for some reason you needed to install a door here, then simply turn the stairs around so they will be facing in the opposite direction. Next up, let's go ahead and install our ceiling joists. We're going to use 2x10, and they are going to be spaced 16 inches on center with mid-span blocks and an access hole for the attic. Now, I went ahead and cut a couple of notches here because the lookouts were in the way. So they were only in the way on this side. That's why we didn't have to notch it on the other side. And I will provide you with a view of that here in a few seconds. And of course, our double ceiling joist. And you don't need to locate it in this bay. You can always move it over. Just try to avoid locating your access near the stairwell, where you could end up with a liability problem if you were climbing up a ladder and the ladder fell into the stairway. Then you're going to be going down a little bit further. Instead of if it's over here and the ladder falls over, you're only going to be falling a few feet. Not that that will always make a difference, but just another thing to think about when you're designing your project. And for those of you who have noticed, we used a 2x4 on both sides for our ceiling backing. We're going to be able to nail our 2x4 into the gable studs. Next up, let's go ahead and install our roof rafters. And we will be using 2x10 for the roof rafters. You might be able to get away with using smaller lumber. And of course, here we have a view of our seat cuts and our blocking, along with the shaped blocking so we can nail our sheathing to the top of the blocks. And to locate the opening for the access hole, all I did was added a doubler to this side of the ceiling joist and to this side of the ceiling joist. And keep in mind that most access holes need to be at least 22.5 inches by 22.5 inches. However, that could change if you were going to be installing some type of a forced air heating and air conditioning unit in the attic. And if that's the case, most of the time it will need to be 30 inches by 30 inches. Next up, let's go ahead and install the lookouts, and then we'll kind of zoom in here to see where this isn't going to be a problem. However, it will be on the other side, requiring us to notch around the top of the ceiling joist or move the lookout board up a little bit. Next up, let's go ahead and install our gable studs for the end of the building. And if you notice here, we have the block notched over the 2x4 backing that will be used for the drywall ceiling. And you could always line a couple of these blocks up and install a strap across maybe 3 or 4 of them to create even a stronger connection. But you can see here where we have tied this block to the gable stud that is attached to the plate. And this is going to help to prevent the wall from moving in either direction. And this will help to prevent the wall from moving forward or backwards. And of course, you could always install more blocks along the edge here and space them maybe 48 inches on center. Next up, let's go ahead and install the fascia board and provide you with a view of how that's going to attach to the lookouts and to the roof rafters. And I believe somebody asked why I used large fascia board for this project. And that's just simply another design modification that you can change if you don't want to use larger fascia board. Next up, let's go ahead and take a look at the bracing here that we will install at both ends of the building. And this will kind of act as a brace that will help to provide structural support for this wall to prevent it from moving in this direction, along with a brace here that will help us to prevent the ridge from moving in either direction. And you're probably wondering, how is it going to work? How's one part going to support the other part? And in reality, once you sheet the building and install some drywall, you're going to create a bracing system that should help to provide support for both parts of the building. And something else you could do, even though I don't see it done all the time, will be to install a brace on both sides of the ridge, or use thicker lumber, maybe a 2x6 or a 2x8, if that will work for you. And here you can see where the bottom of the brace is sitting on top of the wall framing. So we're going to connect this brace to the wall framing plate along with our ceiling backing and our gable wall stud. And then of course we don't have to notch the block here because I'm having the block run through here and then having the ceiling backing stop at the block. So the ceiling backing will be nailing to the block in this example here, instead of running the ceiling backing all the way across like we would have done with the ceiling joist. And of course you can nail some 16D nails into here to connect the brace to the ridge and try to have this at a 45 degree angle or less. And let's not forget our collar ties. And even though these are spaced 16 inches on center, you might be able to get away with spacing them 48 inches on center, or one on every third rafter if your rafters are laid out at 16 inches on center. And then of course you will sheet the roof, and we are done with this video. And if you are enjoying the series, let us know by leaving a comment in the comment area or hitting the thumbs up button.